My name is Oliver Hall, and I come from Dodge City, Garden City area, southwestern Kansas, and I'm a co-owner of Global Green Productions, and we do educational books and educational films, like PBS films. My father came up to what was Hutchinson, Kansas, back in like the late 40s, early 50s. And when he left Arkansas, he had to hitch a ride and get out of there, and he had to leave his farm that he was working on because he could never pay it off. And it's called sharecropping. People don't understand. Sharecropping was a form of slavery. He could never pay off any of his debts. So he just walked away from it. And then I heard years later, after he then passed away, that all the animals had died, and they suffered horrendously because my aunts and cousins told me when they went out to the farm, everything was dead. And I finally understood what my father, how my father was when it came to animals. So when I was a little kid, if an animal wasn't fed on time or wasn't watered, whatever, he would go ballistic. And I never understood that. All these years later, now I understand. Because he was carrying that guilt of having to walk away from his farm to be able to be free. So then he came to Hutchinson, Kansas. And there, I was born outside of Hutchinson and a little town called Lyons, Kansas. And in Lyons, Kansas, Lyons, Kansas is a German community. Simon's probably still heavy German. And he had to learn how to speak German to be able to get around the town because they were not going to speak English. They refused to speak English. They said, you're going to learn how to speak German, and he did. I don't know how he did it, but he did. And he's able to buy groceries and get around and all that. And I was born in that little town. And one of the first things, my dad was sitting in a corner, around a corner, and he's watching through the glass. Some nurses around the corner said, look, we have a chocolate drop in here. So even when I was, even though unaware, racism was always instantly a part of my life. So my dad got to experience that. So we moved out of that area. I ended up going to Dodge City, Kansas, went to high school there, and the experiences there were amazing. I had people who lived back there who were my friends, but my experiences were people that I knew would try to run me over when I'm walking across the street, because that's what you did to black people. You try to run them over. Even though they knew me, it didn't really matter. You know, at night, it was fair game. During the daytime, when I went to school with them, it was okay. You know, so it's like there's two different worlds. You live in the world where you were hunted at night, and during the daytime, you're okay. And my dad had a business there. He had a construction business. And he was the only black man in the area to have a construction business. So that was a whole other level of craziness there. He had to deal with the city itself, the city of Dodge City. He had to fight them to be able to get city contracts. And so when he did, and he won, they gave him city contracts, and then years later, they took everything away from him. So they blocked him out of all contracts. He had to go outside the city to be able to keep his business running. And then years later, I get to meet Julie, my business partner, and her and I start this business, Global Green Productions. And when we started it, we had this mission statement. And it basically was that whatever we do needs to empower, educate, and help people. It can't be nothing other than that. And we know it, and her and I discussed this, we knew we'd never make a lot of money, but what we would do would be able to last probably forever. And that's who we are, and that's what our company is. Like in the next year or so, we're gonna try to have a base of operations in Canada or some other country, because we know we really can't survive here. Things have become way too evil. Just Sunday, it would be like what? The election was Tuesday. And Sunday we went out to eat. We had a waitress come over and she saw us and she walked away from the table. They had to send another waitress over. It was that immediate. People dislike you so much they won't even wait on you. So we've had all kinds of experiences like that. People not waiting on us, people coming in. We were in Topeka after a book festival. This lady walks in, she sees all of us. She took our orders and then she walked out the back. And we waited for like 30 or 40 minutes and another waitress had to come in and said, did she take your orders? And we were like, yes. And she said, well, she just left. Just walked out the back. No explanation, nothing. So her and I experienced stuff like that like all the time. Being pulled over by the police, being followed a lot by the police. I've been pulled over so many times, I can't even count them. And usually it's the same thing. So what are you doing? When the police pull me over, they ask me, what am I doing? So I tell them, like, you know, I'm just driving in this area. And they're like, well, you know, other times I said, you know, you really don't belong in this area. And I've never gotten a ticket over them pulling me over. I have to say that the police were, like, so stunned by a lot of my answers. They didn't give me a ticket. They just looked at my driver's license and said, yeah, you need to move on and don't come in this area anymore. So that's before Trump. So now I can only imagine what's going to happen. What's going to happen now after him. So yeah, we need to be someplace where it's safe. And I see that women are being attacked more than ever before. It's beyond reality. So, and I have daughters, and one of my daughters is gay. So I can only imagine what's going to happen to her. All this gay bashing and craziness that's going on, she's really under attack. So it's pretty scary. Before I left around, it was like 1997 or 98, before I moved to Lawrence, the Klan was openly putting out leaflets in people's yards and stuff. And I knew some of the members. That's how small the communities are. They felt comfortable enough, a Klan member feels comfortable enough to go to a black man and leave a Klan, like a Klan leaflet in your yard. Like, hey, Holly, what you doing? Hey, you want one of these? Well, sure, man, I can't wait to join. You know, just that insanity that they don't, there's the disconnect down there. That hatred is such a built-in part of this system of like of America that people don't even understand they're insulting you or threatening your life. They think it's just all normal. Like they thought it was normal to try to run me over when I walked across the White Earth Boulevard. They thought it was just normal to run me over. Meow, try to run me over. And it was like, and I had to walk like I wasn't afraid, but of course I was afraid, you know? It was scary. Posse Comitatus, the hate group that was based out of like Utah or Montana, was coming through the area. My dad was so afraid. My dad wanted to give me a gun. I was like, I'm not gonna take a gun. I'm not part of nothing. He stayed awake all the time when I'd come home. He would be at the door waiting, you know, afraid. Because all stuff he experienced, all my father experienced. I had another little tidbit that when my dad was a kid down in Arkansas, the Klan came through chasing a black man through the neighborhood, chased him to the river. Then they came walking back. No one said nothing. That man was gone. Of course, they murdered him and threw his body in the river. They did that almost every day or whenever they had a chance. You didn't walk down in Arkansas late at night in the 20s or 30s by yourself down a road. Someone could come by and pick you up and string you up just because they could. And he had to live with that all his life. So then he moves to Kansas. He has a son. He thinks a lot of that's gone. No. So all these groups are back again. Now the 80s and 90s, and now here we are. 2016. How much has really changed? You know, now the hate groups are back out again, full force. And now I see people on Facebook and other social media trying to normalize hate, saying that give Trump a chance, give these hate groups a chance. Well, I guess they didn't see the color of my skin. Can I afford to give them a chance? Really? You have to be crazy to think that I'm going to give them a chance, give these people a chance. No, I am not. About the Great Dance Troupe. It's been around nearly 1,000 years, founded by Rumi, and that will go to PBS. So we're doing stuff like that, and I really love them because it's educating people, it's helping people, and empowering people. It's giving people hope, and we really need hope right now, more than ever.